God. Live in us, that we might bear the light of Christ for all to see. Overshadow us with your presence, that we might be truly blessed and offer your blessing of love to the world. We pray in your holy name. Amen.
We live on the brink every day. We stand in the threshold between this world and the next. We live and move between the ordinary and the divine, between the mundane and the mystery. Too often we forget to look up and see the angels near us. We forget that the love we give and live is a sign of eternity, God with us right now. Luke tells us that God's favor came to a girl, an ordinary girl. It might have been you or your daughter. It might have been the girl down the street or your granddaughter. But the messenger of God came and greeted her and said, "The Lord is with you." What a gift and what a promise. Emmanuel, God is with us. We light these candles with peace in our hearts for the promise and the newness of God. Even when we forget to listen, to lean into the presence, God is as close as our own breath. In a confused and confusing world, this is a peace that passes all understanding. It is the peace that knows God is near. Please join me. O come, Emmanuel. And our hymn is Emmanuel, number 204.
Thank you. The Old Testament reading is from 2 Samuel 7. Now when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." That same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan. "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people, Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now therefore, thus you say, shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture and following the sheep to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make your great name like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel and plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more, and evildoers shall afflict them no more as formerly. From the time when I appointed judges over my people Israel, I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares that the Lord will make you a house. Your house and your kingdoms shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." And our responsive reading today is from the Canticle of Mary, page 199 in the hymnal. "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord.
My spirit rejoices in God my Savior. He has looked with favor on me, a lowly servant.
From this day all generations shall call me blessed.
The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is the name of the Lord, whose mercy is on those who fear God from generation to generation.
The arm of the Lord is strong and has scattered the proud in their conceit.
God has cast down the mighty from their thrones and lifted up the lowly.
God has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich empty away.
God has come to the aid of Israel, the chosen servant, remembering the promise of mercy, the promise made to our forebears, to Abraham and his children forever.
These are the words of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And if the ushers would please come forward, it's time to return gifts to the Lord.
The epistle today is from Romans 16, and I'll be reading from the Message Bible. All of our praise rises to the one who is strong enough to make you strong, exactly as preached in Jesus Christ. precisely as revealed in the mystery kept secret for so long, but now an open book through the prophetic scriptures. All the nations of the world can now know the truth and be brought into obedient belief, carrying out the orders of God, who got all this started, down to the very last letter. All our praise is focused through Jesus on this incomparably wise God. Yes, these are the words of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And if the children would like to come forward, it's children's time.
Hi, Maddie.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Reagan, I didn't even hear you. Try it one more time. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. Can you tell me what an entrance is? What? An entrance is what?
Something that you go through to get somewhere. And
Something you go through to get someplace. So did you come into an entrance this morning?
Yes.
What was the entrance? Right, the front doors, right? Now what if you would have happened if you'd have gotten here today and the doors would have been locked? What do you think you would have done?
You'd call somebody.
What is going on?
Oh, they'd have called somebody to see what was going on? Yeah. Could you have gotten in if it was locked?
No.
No, but maybe if you called somebody and figured out what was going on. So, you know, we're kind of like an entrance. We can be locked. Or we can be open. Last week, did we talk about opposites? Reagan, do you remember? Did we talk about opposites last week? Yeah. So our hearts can be open, or our hearts can be closed. Now let's take a look at Mary. We talked about Mary last week. You know, the angel came to Mary and said, you're going to have a baby. And was Mary open to that, or was she closed? Did she say, oh no, I'm not going to do that?
Open.
Or she was open, wasn't she? Yeah, she was open. So we have to be open so God can use us. You know, Mary was just a peasant girl. She wasn't a queen. She wasn't the daughter of a queen, of a king. She wasn't anybody important. She was just a plain person, just like us. And God can use us to do all kinds of things, little things or big things. So I'm going to see today if I have some risk takers. Are you ready? Because I have some envelopes here. And in this envelope, there's something you can do. Just like God's going to ask us to do things. Now, if you are a risk taker and are going to try one of my envelopes, there may be a prize in my package. But if you don't want to try it, if you don't want to be a risk taker, that's fine. Who wants to be a risk taker? Oh, okay. All right. Kelby, you want to be a risk taker?
Sure.
Jonathan, you want to be a risk? No, you don't want to be? You sure? Casey, you want to be a risk taker? Yeah. Oh, all right, who wants to open theirs first?
Me.
All right, Elizabeth, go first. What does it say in there? You see what it says? Raven, can you help her?
Run in place.
Run in place. Okay, stand up. Can you do it?
Mm-hmm.
All right, try it. Oh, good job. All right, who wants to be next? All right,
Marcy, or Marcy. Marcy, you want to try it?
I'm good.
All right, Reagan.
What does it say?
Reach down and touch hands on the floor. You're not that flexible.
Oh, okay, she did it. All right, who wants to be next? All right, Ollie. Can you need help open?
Just keep on moving.
Okay, it just you should just be able to go behind there. There you go. Wow, that one is really taped.
Okay. Rise up on your tippy toes.
Oh! Oh, good job. All right, who else wants to be next? Okay, you're going to be all right. What does yours say?
Up your arms above your head to raise the roof.
Oh, you know how to raise the roof? Can you do that? Oh, okay. Oh, wait a minute. We got Casey. What does Casey say to do?
Well, he dropped it. Casey, ready? No, open it for you. Yeah, take mine.
He just wants a paper. What does his say?
Touch your nose with your finger.
Oh!
He can do that.
He can. Can you touch your nose with your finger?
Casey.
Where's your nose?
Casey. Where's your nose at?
Well, I guess we're going to save the best till last.
Oh, of course. All right, Kelby, let's see what you can do.
Touch your nose?
Stand on one foot.
Oh! Oh! Oh, okay. So since you took a risk, Jonathan, you sure you don't want to try a risk? Are you really sure? Because look what you're going to get if you take a risk. You're going to get a prize. You know, if God said, uses us for something. You know, Mary, what did she do? She had off. She gave birth to Jesus. Now, we are going to have that important of a job, but we all are going to, God wants us to use us for something. All right, let's pray, and then I'll give you your prize, all right? Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for Mary.
Thank you for Mary.
Who said yes to your plan.
Who said yes to your plan.
Help us to also say yes.
Help us to also say yes.
To your plans for us and others.
To your plans for us and others.
Thank you and amen.
Thank you and amen.
All right, come by here and I will give you your prize.
I'm not sharing with Jonathan, maybe.
I was going to say, I think I'll give Jonathan one anyway.
Jonathan.
You're welcome. There you go. Woo. Did everybody get one?
Got your pencil ready? Get your pencil out? Did you use them? Hey, what do you say?
Good job.
Good job.
And our next hymn is number 234. We're going to sing the four verses that are printed and then skip over and do verse 6. And you don't have to sing the Latin version. We'll skip that one. Second number one.
Thank you.
hearing of the gospel will enlighten us.
Gracious God, as we turn to your word for us, may the Spirit of God rest upon us. Help us to be steadfast in our hearing, our speaking, our believing, and our living. Amen.
The gospel is from Luke 1. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." And she was much perplexed by his words, and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy, and will be called the Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and is in the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. How did it happen? It seems that just a few days ago, the leaves were turning from green to their beautiful fall colors. And now, suddenly, it's December 20th, and Christmas Day is just 5 days away. It truly is almost Christmas. During the first three Sundays of Advent, we've pondered questions that John Wesley raised to make folks more aware of their faith and to make him more aware of his faith. And we've considered how to move from being almost Christians to being altogether Christians. This morning, instead of a song, our Psalter responsive reading was the Magnificat, the Canticle of Mary. This song of praise is found in the Gospel of Luke. Luke records that Mary sang this while she was visiting Elizabeth. And I think about Mary often during Advent. God asked her to do something that seemed to be totally impossible. But the angel Gabriel told her, nothing is impossible with God. And it was so. Even though Mary's canticle is part of our lectionary today, and Christmas is just 5 days away, Mary did not conceive Jesus with the Holy Spirit and give birth 5 days later. Like any other mother-to-be, she had to wait 9 long months as the baby grew within her. And then at the end, she had to ride a donkey many miles from Nazareth to Bethlehem. It took time. And James Howell says that's how God comes to us too. We don't become fully Christian, totally following Christ in a moment. That also takes time. In our study about becoming fully Christian, we have just three questions to consider this week. And our first thought might be, oh good, it's an easy week. Well, we've all been students. And we know that when we aren't asked as much, when we're given a shorter assignment, that usually means that it's weightier and harder, and it's going to make us think even more. And I think that's true of our questions. The first question this week is, do I believe that Christ loved me and gave himself for me? I think it's easy to say, well, yes. But whenever we get a seemingly simple question from a teacher, A simple yes is never an adequate answer. And so it is with this question. When the angel Gabriel told Mary she had found favor with God and would conceive a child, the Son of God, Mary asked, "How can this be?" I've thought of that often when considering the sacrifice that Jesus made for me and for all of us. How could God ask Mary to do that? How could God ask his Son to suffer and die? How could Jesus do it? Jesus was without sin. How could he have given himself up for me? But he did. He loves me, and he loves every one of us that much. In our liturgy for the sacrament of Holy Communion, we hear proclaimed this good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. And we are all forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. We're all children of God. God loves each one of us tenderly, fiercely, aggressively. God loves us even if we have moments in our past or in our present that are kind of dark. God loves us even though we aren't perfect. And God loves us even though he knows that we never will be perfect. God loves us so much that he gave up his Son to prove his love for us. You know, Mary accepted God's call by simply saying, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Could I have done that? Could you have done that? I wonder if I could have accepted the word of God and readily agreed to do something as overwhelming as Mary's call from God. I'd like to say, yes, of course I would. But would I really? That's certainly a question to ponder. God asks each of us to accept that he is real. Do we truly believe in him? Wesley's next question says, "Do I have faith in Christ's blood?" And that's Wesley's way of posing that question of, do we believe? Do we have faith? Back in 1876, Robert Lowry wrote a hymn that asked, "Oh, what can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus." You know, blood is kind of icky. It's usually not something we like to think about. But blood is essential for life. The average adult has about 1.5 gallons of blood in their body. In medical terms, that's 10 units. And although many medical advances have been made, antibiotics, transplantation of organs, and vaccines for many illnesses, safe and effective artificial blood hasn't yet been created. In the same way, no thing and no person can provide the saving grace that Christ freely gives to all. The Apostle Paul told the people of Colossae that through Jesus Christ, God was pleased to reconcile himself to all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace with the blood of his cross. Jesus' blood cleansed every one of us. His blood claimed us. His blood reconciled us with God. Jesus didn't just suffer for the world. He suffered for each and every one of us individually. And that's deep stuff to think about right before our celebration of Christ's birth. Jesus' entire life, his birth, his ministry, his healings, it's all important. But even during Advent, we need to remember that Christ lived and died and continues to reign with God now and forever. We can't forget that Jesus shed his blood for our redemption, for our reconciliation, and for the restoration of the entire world. Nothing but the blood of Jesus could do all that. And because he had faith in Christ's blood, John Wesley wondered, "Do I believe that Jesus has taken away my sins and cast them as a stone into the depths of the sea?" I don't think it's any secret that I greatly admire John Wesley, but he struggled with his faith for many, many years. He had to study and work to be able to answer yes to that question. He was an ordained Anglican priest, the son of an Anglican priest, the grandson of an Anglican priest. His mother, Susanna, was very spiritual, and she taught her many children from the Bible every day. John and his brother Charles, when they became adults, led a group called the Holy Club, a group they created to study and pursue devout Christian life. But for many years, John Wesley just didn't truly believe that Jesus had redeemed him. How could he not? John Wesley knew in his head that he had been redeemed, but he didn't know it in his heart. And then on May 27, 1738, John attended a meeting of the Holy Club on Aldersgate Street in London. And as he listened to a reading written by Martin Luther about the preface to the book of Romans, Wesley says that his heart was strangely warmed. It was then that he finally felt Jesus in his heart. Although he had pondered the question of his salvation again and again, it wasn't until this moment that he truly felt it. God's grace pursued him, and God's grace also pursues us. God doesn't remember our worst moments. God doesn't think about our sins and our failures. God loves us, each and every one, and that's why God sent his Son to earth. The Gospel of Luke tells us that after Jesus was born, and the shepherds and the angels who visited the stable and departed, that Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. Mary had faith. She pondered, giving careful thought to all that had happened. We also need to ponder what has happened to us and what is happening to us. We have to allow ourselves to be open to receive God's gift to us with humility and with faith. As the body of Christ, we are called to be Christ for the world. How do we do that? Well, one way we do that is something that we've been doing for the last few weeks. Our food collection in the basement has grown and grown. And that's one way we can be Christ. We are being the hands of Christ whenever we help others. Mary grew up in Nazareth. It was a tiny town. James Howe calls it a small backwater village of no account. When Jesus was growing and he'd been baptized by John, Jesus sought to gather his disciples. Philip chose to follow him. And Philip told his friend Nathanael that we have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth. And Nathanael said, can anything good come out of Nazareth? And that's probably what people thought about Mary. How could a young girl from Nazareth be the mother of the Messiah? But she was. Back in the 14th century, there was a German theologian known as Meister Eckhart. And he wrote, we are all meant to be mothers of God. What good is it to me if this eternal birth of the divine Son takes place unceasingly, but does not take place within myself? And what good is it to me if Mary is full of grace, if I am not also full of grace? What good is it to me for the Creator to give birth to his Son, if I also do not give birth to him in my time and my culture? This, then, is the fullness of time, when the Son of God is begotten in us. These words are as true for us today as they were over 700 years ago when Meister Eckhart wrote them. We also need to be full of grace, and we also need to recognize that God comes to each one of us. The joy of the Lord is my strength. These words are found in the Old Testament book of Nehemiah. The people of Israel had returned to Jerusalem after exile, and as they listened to Ezra reading the words of the law, they were overcome with sorrow because they had not been living as faithful followers of God. But God loved them anyhow. God loves us too. This week, healthcare professionals in our area have received the first round of the COVID vaccine, and people have proclaimed, it's the best news ever. And it's good news. It's very good news. In 1955, the year I was born, a vaccine developed by a virus researcher named Jonas Salk was declared to be an effective cure for polio. That was good news. It was very good news. And I'm sure people then also called it the best news ever. And both vaccines are very good news. I disagree, however, that either one is the best news ever. I believe the best news ever is that God sent his Son to earth to be the Savior of the world. As we prepare our hearts, not just our minds, not just our hands to open the presents, but our hearts to celebrate the birth of our Savior this week, we know that God is a God of joy. We thought about how having altogether peace, altogether hope, altogether love, and altogether joy have moved us from being almost Christians to altogether Christians, so that we can celebrate an altogether Christmas. Reverend Matt Walsh says that altogether joy goes beyond just a feeling of happiness. It's a steadfast assurance that God is with us now and always. Unfortunately, not all people will feel happy this week. Too many are mourning the loss of someone dear. Many are alone because of illness or other circumstances. But Rawls says that joy can be present even when happiness is not. He says that joy is the culmination of our Advent celebration because joy is a gift. I have to tell you that I'm going to have to think about that and ponder how the gift of joy can be with us even when happiness is not. but I'm sure God is going to help me understand how that is. Our celebration of Christ's birth is very near. As each of us ponders the gift of joy this week, we need to be sure to thank God for the gift of the Christ child. The Prince of Peace is the hope of the world, the ultimate gift of love, and the source of our joy. We will receive abundant gifts this week, not the gifts we hope to find under our Christmas trees, but the gifts we receive from the Prince of Peace, the joy of salvation, and the promise of eternal life. And that, friends, is the altogether love and hope and joy we find as altogether Christians, celebrating an altogether Christmas. Christ our Savior is born. Thanks be to God. Amen. And our final hymn is number 220, Angels from the Realms of Glory. After Christmas. This week is Christmas. The Christmas Eve service is at 6. Please let Steve know if you're planning to attend so we can kind of get the pews marked off if we need to. And Friday is Christmas Day. The blood drive at St. John's was postponed until January 12th. As of now, we'll wait to see what they have to say. If you'll take a look at our prayer list, we talked about several people last week who I noted this morning. Amy Wheeling, who had appendectomy last week. She wasn't moving fast, but she was at the ball game the other night. I'm assuming she's still doing well. Hannah and Bailey and Tanner and Mandy all are have COVID and are coming along.
Everybody's recuperated except Bailey, and she's still on the PME list for another week, so she's feeling much better though.
And we remember Ernie, who we talked about last week, two friends that are suffering from cancer, Marty Spahn and Mary Wood. Mary had some tests this week. I don't really remember what I read, but I know we needed to kind of keep her in our, especially in our minds again. And Taffy Hoos, a friend of ours. Are there other people that we need to add? Are there celebrations, Steve?
Update on several people. The Masonic Lodge delivered fruit baskets at Christmas to widows and to shut-in Masons. I delivered a Christmas basket yesterday to C.W. Coolin. And he looked great, sounded great, said to tell everybody hi. He seems to be doing very well. He is living at the senior apartment house. I know there was concern he might not be able to stay by himself, but seems to be doing well. Junior Seifert, who is on our list already because of his Parkinson's, he has had COVID very seriously. There was concerns, you know, that he might not survive it, but he is recovering. And then we need to add David Troxell and Karen Troxell to our list. They're both dealing with serious health issues.
Elsie and McKenna Whelan both have COVID now, so we just got to remember them this week. And then, did anybody else see on Facebook where Orville said he had COVID and came out of it?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's something to be thankful for. He's, what, is he 90?
Close to 90.
And he had COVID and he's good now, but that's pretty miraculous. And then, continued prayers for the same little girls that I mentioned last week. It's my understanding that they are not with parents or grandparents at the moment. I think it's scary, but for them, but I'm really happy about it. So we're just gonna, I think we should just pray that that stays for a very long time.
Anything else?
I have Jeff Wild out here, and I think Dorothy said this morning that he passed.
Yeah, Jack Wild passed away, so I'll remove him from my list. Anything else? I have to tell you about a brief visit I had this week. One day when Erin was not working, she called me and said, Mom, there's an SUV coming to your house. It's a woman who says that she is David Townley's daughter and she wants to go up to the Townley Cemetery. And so she drove up and I talked to her, you know, from the porch and talked to her about how to get up there. I said, it's not an easy walk, but she walked up to the cemetery, she came back and rang the doorbell, and she was crying. She said, that was so important to me. Thank you so very much. All I did was say, yeah, park the car and go, but it was nice to see her. She was very, very nice and a very pretty young lady. I don't know of anything else.
You want to talk about the DS visit?
Another interesting visit I had this week is my doorbell rang and I went to the front door. You know, my doorbell doesn't ring very often. And it was our district superintendent. And she had a pie for me, this huge pie. It was like a 10-inch in diameter apple pie that Dwayne and Kelby managed to get rid of. and a little gift of a olive wood cross from Bethlehem. And she apparently was going around to every pastor in our district, I think there are 80 pastors, to deliver a pie and a little gift and thank the pastors for, you know, this year, which has been a little different kind of year. So I was very impressed that she found our house, to be perfectly honest.
Did you ask her if there was any other pastor that lived as remotely as you do?
She did say, well, we have quite a view from up here.
Oh, I do have one more. Bonnie Ford has another procedure on New Year's Eve. So I don't know if I said that last week or not, but just remember her as that comes up. She's actually excited about this one. I think she, in her heart of hearts, believes that this could be the last one. So hopefully.
That sounds good. That sounds like a good idea. Anything else? Steve.
Well, it may be in the way of celebration. Rhonda has paid all the bills on our hail damage repairs and our enhancements. We are now dealing with the insurance company. We just found out Friday we are on our third different church mutual person that's in charge of our case. This one has a foreign name, but the lady I talked to, she must have spelled it a dozen times before I got it right. So in order to expedite the process, she said in addition to contacting that person, I could also email Church Mutual's claim department. So somewhere along the line, somebody's going to get back to us. But at least we've paid all the bills, and now we're just waiting for the final insurance settlement.
I have an update on some of that, too. There was some discussion with regard to the side door off the ramp. I did talk to Grayson, and we are on his schedule for early spring. He is somewhat behind in some of his jobs, so he says, golly, it might be spring before I can get to it. And I said, well, that'd be perfect, because that's what we had discussed. Also, I have given Doug and Cindy Sig the go-ahead for new front doors with stained glass inserts. Steve and I went by Brady's Glass and checked out their work and was impressed and came up with some ideas with regard to glass on the outside and glass on the inside to protect the window itself, which I think is an excellent idea, and also maybe will help us with future insurance questions. So anyway, that's in the works. They said, I think that that would take a couple of months to do, so we probably won't have that till spring either.
As a follow-up to that, you know, the Ina and I met, the guy's name is Nathaniel Johnson. He looks like an artist, and he is an artist. The glass, I have a picture of what the doors look like that we submitted. If everybody's okay with that, they'll go ahead. This guy also said he can do anything we want. I brought a sample of his work. It's unbelievable. I mean, if there's any concern about the design, which we've said so far, which is the cross and plane, he can do anything. But if you want to see a sample of his work or what we think the doors are going to look like, I do have pictures.
That was in a church event.
Yeah, this particular one is in a church event. He didn't know exactly where, he didn't remember, but it's apparently behind the altar. I guess they have a big window behind their altar. But if anybody wants to see this, if not, if we're in agreement as to what we've already submitted, I'll contact him this week and give him the go-ahead. He did think 4 to 6 weeks on doing the stained glass.
I think SIGs are conversing with him.
Okay, yeah, well, we'll touch base with him just to make sure. Yeah.
We don't want to
confuse anything, right?
And our sign, if you haven't noticed, it was installed this week, and it is absolutely beautiful, I think.
So. And we're going to trim the bush today so that it's more visible.
That's a good idea. Anything else?
One final thing. We need to meet right after church informally to discuss the families that we want to help for Christmas. So if we just kind of move up front a little bit, we'll do that very quickly.
All right. Anything else? Let us pray and have the Lord's Prayer and our benediction. Dear God, we come to you today blessing you, thanking you for the joy that you have brought to us by sending your Son to earth. We thank you for all of the joy you give us each and every day. We thank you for allowing us to be able to update and beautify your place of worship, this house. We thank you for all of those people that you have managed to that have managed to recover from COVID, that are doing well, although they do have COVID. And we have in our hearts all of the people that we know, even those that we haven't named, who need your loving care and need to feel your healing and need to know that you are with them. We have so many people that we remember today. Amy and Anna and Bailey and Bonnie and Ernie and Junior and June and Holly and Mary and Marty and Orville and Taffy and Tanner and David Troxell and Elsie and McKenna and Jack Wiles' family. We remember all of these people. We help want you to place your loving arms around them and help them to know that you are with them now and always. We thank you for the joy that you have brought to our lives. And we ask you to help us to remember to share that joy with those we meet this week as we can proclaim joy to the world. Our Lord has come. Our Lord taught us many things, and our Lord taught the prayer to his disciples that we now say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, let us go forth in peace. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.